Maybe we don't talk about movies at all, right?
There you go.
Hello again.
Hello.
Long time no see.
Yeah, a long time.
Are you enjoying the post-game festivities? This movie's now... How long has it been since this movie actually premiered?
It premiered, March 29th. So, what is that, 6 months?
It's like practically a full...
7 months.
Full-grown child by now in movie years.
It is. I mean, it's out. It's had its life, you know. It's on DVD and, people whatever stream it, and you know it's strange because there's no like reason for it to still be talked about really, except that I guess people still want to talk about it, so I go wherever I need to go to talk about it.
Is it strange to be talking about it so much later?
Well, I mean, no, because you have to support your films for their whole life. You know what I mean?
You'll be out there forever.
They're like your children. You have to go support them. I mean, I've been writing and working on new things. So I'm not in. I've like moved beyond Pines as a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
So it's definitely in talking about it. I'm talking about something in the past. I'm not talking about my present anymore.
Right.
So that's the only thing that's changed. It's just hindsight. Looking back on it.
Is it strange, like watching Dane DeHaan do this and that, and kind of become hot again? And
I mean, Dane's gotten. The only thing strange about seeing Dane is like he looks so big now. He's been lifting weights. I think Hollywood decided that he's one to. He's gonna make it big, and they gave him like a healthy diet and regimen, and they gave him like a weight training program, and now like he was always like kind of skinny, and now he's all buff. I can see him starting to his physique starting to look like Ryan's.
Well, Ryan didn't always look like that.
No, that's what I'm saying. Right. Yeah. I mean, all great actors can have this. Can be shapeshifters. Yeah.
I have this theory actually. The other day we were having a conversation, I thought, if anybody's going to go the Brando route, Ryan seems like the guy. Like, at some point, he's just going to go fuck it and put on 200 pounds.
Well,
and just be happy.
I mean, I think he did, I think he put on quite a bit of weight at one point and then lost it, And, but yeah, no doubt. I mean, he's, just directed his own film. And I love One-Eyed Jacks, Brando's One-Eyed Jacks. I mean, look, Ryan's Ryan. No one is going to... He's going to be his own legend, I think, someday. I think he'll be someone that no one can compare him to. He'll just be him. He already is just him, you know?
It is unique. It's really, for a guy who seems, he does all these smaller movies, he does the bigger movies, that kind of seems like he can play to any park.
Mm.
And yet he seems like uninterested in the fame part almost completely.
Yeah, I'm not sure of his relationship with that, except to just know him as like a, as a person who's been fortunate enough to collaborate with him a few times. He's a dream to work with and to collaborate with because he's just full of ideas and full of magic and full of gifts. I've never seen him stumped. I've never seen him dead. Do you know what I mean? Mm. I've never seen him tired. I've only seen him full of life, and I think he has so much, so much that he's already put out into the world in his in his 30 something years that he's been here, and I think I'm excited to see what else he can do in his next 60 years or whatever he has.
Yeah, I think when Only God Forgives came out, people were a little freaked out by what he wasn't doing.
Mm.
In the movie, it was like,
I never saw it.
It's it's a wildly over the top as Nicholas Refn can be.
Yeah,
but it's like definitely intentional. I think that's the thing, is like critics, if they don't quite get it, they kind of like, oh, that was a mistake or something. And they're just kind of like, but it was like Ryan's almost silent through most of the film.
Yeah,
but everybody else is talking, and usually in a foreign language, and it's quite amazing to watch him.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he's compelling. He can be on screen and say nothing or say, but the thing about Ryan though that I think is like he's one of the most intelligent people I've ever met.
Mm.
His brain works incredibly fast. It's impossible to have an argument with Ryan because he's thinking like three, four, steps ahead at all times. He's like a master chess player that way. And so he's incredibly gifted at talking, at communicating with people, with dialogue. And so I think, you know, I've always felt, you know, I think he strikes that perfect balance of an actor of being able to hold the screen cinematically because he has a lot going on inside. But if he ever has to express himself, it's just clear as a bell. You know, he has a, and the way I like to work with, you know, working in improvisation quite a bit, I'm always asking my actors to bring something to the table. You know, Ryan, you know, he always has something to bring, even if it doesn't work. There's a scene in Pines where, like, he's supposed to bring the money back to Romina, supposed to give it to her. And she doesn't want it. She wants to, she's just supposed to drive away. So my directions to Ava was just like, just whatever you do, don't take it from him. I told Ryan, just don't let her leave. You know, it's just simple direction. And, you know, during one take, Ryan, you know, she walks out of the diner, goes into her car. He tries to give her the money. She gets in her car, drives off. He couldn't get her to stop. So finally on take five, he just put his head under her tire and she had it in drive. And Ava's just, she's not a great driver. You know, and she was freaking out because she didn't know, you know, I think she gets confused between the gas and the brake sometimes. Hey. But anyway, yeah, so he'll always have, you know, something to do. He'll always bring some kind of surprise to the table.
So you're not going to, you didn't go see that movie. So are you going to rush to go see Bradley's next movie or is that...
I try. I mean, I would have. I just haven't had time to see a lot of movies
because
I've been writing and I have my family. Ever since I had, you know, I used to, before I had kids, I'd go see 9 movies a week. I used to, when I first moved to New York City 14 years ago, I was so overwhelmed by the city that I would just go to a movie theater just to sleep. You know, I would spend all day in the movie theater. I'd go to Film Forum and just watch whatever they programmed, whatever. I just let them decide for me. And I would just go 9 times a week to the movies. And then I had kids, and I spent so much of my life, so much of my childhood watching movies on VHS and spending this time in the movie theater. And then I had kids, and now I have kids, you know? And, like, I don't really have time to watch movies anymore. I mean, if I watch a movie with my wife at night, I mean, usually I spend time writing in the day or working in the day, whatever I'm doing. Then my kids come home, I spend time with them, make dinner, put them to bed, and then work at nighttime. Some nights, my wife makes popcorn and we watch a movie. But if we do that, we make it through halfway, you know, or maybe a third of the way. Then we go to bed and have to pick it up the next night. You know, my life is more, you know, centered, you know, now that I've been able to make movies and have, you know, and now that I have these kids, I just don't watch things. So it's no, you know, I do still want to watch things.
So when you finally go make a movie, is it like going into a bunker for a number of months away from the family or?
You know, what was really nice about Pines is I was able to bring my family with me. That was part of the design of setting it in Schenectady, New York, because my wife was from there. And I shot it in the summertime. And so my kids were out of school. My wife had her family up there. We went up there. She had support. And it was beautiful. You know, I would be shooting nights and I'd come home. And I'd come home as my kids were waking up and they'd, you know, say goodnight to me. And then I remember, you know, I don't drink, and my younger son Cody would bring me an O'Doul's at 3 o'clock in the afternoon to wake me up with an O'Doul's, which was really sweet. And it was the first time that ever happened for me, because before that I had always separated my life, my personal life, from movies. To me, they couldn't interact. I don't know why. I felt like the movie life was a private life. But now that I have my family, I want them there with me. You know, I want them to be on set with me as much as they can. You know, in my next film, you know, hopefully we're going to be shooting in Australia. And so we'll just take a journey down there. We'll just live there for 6 months, you know. But yeah, I kind of need them to be around, you know.
It seems sane.
Huh?
It seems sane.
Sane, yeah. I mean, yes, yeah. My kids. There's something that happens when you have kids and you're an artist, or at least for me. Before I had kids, I was inherently selfish. All I thought about was my work, my ideas, my time, what I was going to do. And once I had kids, I had to become selfless immediately. And becoming selfless has helped my art in more ways than I can explain. It's taken my ego out of the game. It's taken myself, focus on me, out of the game, and it's put it on, bigger things, things that are greater than me, which is kind of why also I've been making films about family and about legacy and about generations. You know, that's really where, that's where my heart and my focus are.
Is the process more relaxed for you in some ways because you're more at peace in that way?
Well, I trust the process now. That's not to say that I'm comfortable, because I'm not comfortable. Mm-hmm. I feel like comfort is the great enemy of anything, really. I think once you get comfortable, you can just stagnate. I think there's that great line in Heat where Al Pacino's like, I need my angst, it keeps me on the edge where I need to be. Mm-hmm. And as a filmmaker, I definitely need angst. I need that, I need that fire. I need that discomfort. Otherwise, it's like the Smurfs without Gargamel, you need Gargamel in your life. You need something to. So I definitely have plenty of things that I struggle with. Mm-hmm. But I trust the process. I trust that if I put in the time and the work, I trust that it'll come. For instance, the other night I was writing this script and I came to a place where I got, where I got stuck, and it's 12:30 at night, and I wanted to have the script done that night. Mm-hmm. I had this one spot that I got stuck on, and so I was staring at my computer and I was bleary-eyed, and I just said, I'm just gonna go to sleep. And I just put the problem in my mind and I went to sleep. And when I woke up, it was solved. Mm. So I'm to a point now where I can trust my unconscious, my subconscious, that it's gonna take care of things,
Do you feel like it certainly seems from this movie, and I assume will be your next movie, that actors want to kind of come play in your process?
I hope so. Yeah, I hope so. I've been very fortunate with the actors that I've worked with on these last couple of movies. With Ryan and Michelle and Ray and Ava and Bradley and Dane and Emery and Mendelsohn, Rose Byrne, Bruce Greenwood. All these actors who, gave of their hearts and their time, to be in the movie. And I think they all, I enjoyed working with each and every one of those actors. And I think they all had interesting experiences making the movie, I think the way I approach filmmaking, directing, is I consider myself to be like the coach, so I and my actors are my players, and they're the ones that I want to succeed. They're the ones that I want to shine or not. They're the ones who I need to be vulnerable. They're the ones that are putting themselves really at risk, not me. Mm. I'm behind the camera, it's easy, but when you're in front of the camera, you're vulnerable, and so I love and respect them for that, so I certainly, there's a number of actors that I would love to have an opportunity to work with, people that I'm thinking about for my next films, and I hope I'll be able to to make some more dreams come true.
The Mendelsohn thing,
yeah,
I'm hooked on the Mendelsohn thing. He's become the most evasive actor for me, at least, in the last couple of years. And it's like the guy does amazing work over and over and over again.
Yes.
He's not playing the same guy at all.
Yeah.
And what is the deal with him? Is he just a great... Does he just come with everything? What is he looking for? Who is this guy?
Well, I didn't know anything about Ben. I had no idea that Ben had been acting since the ripe old age of 13 and was the, you know, Australia's national treasure, you know what I mean? You know, for 30 some years, and that he'd been in, you know, countless movies and TV shows over there. I only had seen Animal Kingdom. And I remember just thinking, who's that guy, you know? And so I wanted to have a meeting with him for Pines, and he showed up to a meeting, and he showed up 3 hours early to the casting room, and he looked like a wreck. And he had on a bracelet, and I couldn't tell if that, if it was from a party the night before, or if it was from the hospital, you know? And he said to me, he says, look, mate, he says, I hope you don't have me audition for you, because if you have me audition for you, that'll be the last thing I get to do for you. He says, but if you just give me the role, I'll carry a spear for you. And I said, okay, you got the role. Within 2 minutes of meeting him, I hired him because he came with me with that. And in kind of having that kind of blatantly honest, upfront conversation, immediately, he did. He gave everything to me. He gave me all of his gifts. He offered everything. Now, the role of Robin that he played in Pines was written as a guy that had no teeth. And so immediately Ben said, he says, what are we going to do about the teeth, Dad? And because for some reason he started calling me Dad immediately. He doesn't call me Dad. He calls me Deca now. But when we're on set, he calls me Dad. I think he must do that to everyone. But he says, what are we going to do about the teeth, Dad? And I said, well, what do you think we should do about the teeth? And he says, well, I've had quite a lot of dental work done. He said, I would be, you know, I'd be more than happy to call my dentist and have my teeth pulled for you. And I said, okay, well, you know, let's just give me your dentist number. You know, this shows you the madness that, you know, the kind of, you know, just how crazy your head can be when you're trying to make something great. You make insane decisions. And so a week later, I had Mendelsohn's dental records, his dental x-rays in my possession. And we were planning a trip, booking a trip for him to go to Australia to get his teeth pulled. And thankfully, my producers, Jamie Patrickoff, Lynette Howell, and Alex Orlovsky, told me that absolutely not. They are not going to buy a ticket for Ben to go to Australia, and that I could not allow him to get his teeth pulled. And so I kicked and screamed, Ben kicked and screamed, and thankfully they won. Thankfully they put our fire out on that one.
Usually you hear producers are like, they want to have more nudity, or they want to have some, you know, something more commercial, and they just, these guys just had to protect his teeth.
Yes. No, my producers, they're great. I trust them. This is kind of the culture I like to have around me on a film set, which is honesty, which is I despise yes men. You know, I want people to just fight with me and disagree, and let's just come up with, let's all put our egos to the side and just think about the movie. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I was only thinking about the movie, Ben was only thinking about the movie, and they were thinking about real life outside of it. And I'm thankful they were. And on the day before we started shooting, I remember sitting with Ben at a farm stand, and we were eating peaches at a farm stand. And I remember watching the juice drip down his chin and thinking to myself how thankful I was that we didn't get his teeth pulled.
That he could eat peaches.
That he could eat peaches. But he just brings I don't know, such a, I would just say, like, I feel like he's might be the, you know, one of the greatest of all time, and I hope that I can make every movie with him.
It's extraordinary. I mean, it really is, like, you kind of watch his stuff and you go, who is this guy? Where did he come from? And you kind of want, like, you kind of want to see just more and more. And he usually is playing small roles. He doesn't seem to.
Well, he's been playing character roles. I mean, yeah. Ben is. He could play the leading man, and I think he's going to be in Ryan Fleck and Anna Boden's movie Mississippi Grind, where he is, you know, the co-lead with Ryan Reynolds. And I can't wait to see that, because he could absolutely carry a movie. I know in Pines, to me, when I watch that movie, he represents the true light of the movie, the life of the movie. When he comes on screen, there's a relief I feel. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? There's a glove I feel. I feel like he carries this beautiful torch of love and of light on the movie screen. And and I hope he gets some opportunities to do, you know, kind of what like John Hawks has done, you know, and mm-hmm. carry some movies, because I know he could do it.
So do you have these relationships with each actor? I mean, is it each like a different? Is the experience of working, besides what's actually going on in the set and what you actually capture on camera in terms of what we see, this process of developing these relationships with each of these people?
Yeah, I try to take, I mean, it's all individual. It's all, you know, their performances on are products of my of our relationship and their relationship to the material. And then they're interacting with the other actors in the scene. But yeah, I try to work individually with every actor. I'm not much for, it depends, but initially I'm not much for bringing all the actors together. I don't do like big readings around a mm-hmm. table. I want to know each person individually, and so me and that person can have a trust, and I can know what that player can do, because like I said, actors to me are the players. They're my athletes. Mm-hmm. And I want to know about them. Mm-hmm. And I want them to know about me, and I want to come up with little secrets that they have, because I think it's great, because all of us walk around this as human beings, as, you know, citizens of this world. We all walk around with our own secrets and our own truths and our own histories. And I feel like I want every actor that's in my movie to know those things about themselves, whether or not they come out or not. I want them just to have secrets inside, and they don't even have to tell me, but I like to work on that with them and then bring the actors together and let them mix and see what that mix starts happening after I have that time to create with the actors. But you know, then again, like I always, you know, in writing, like I'm not a natural writer. I write only because I'm a filmmaker, because I want to get on set and I want to have this process with actors, and I want to see them living on screen. And so I write from a place of instigation and inspiration. All I'm trying to do is just light something under an actor, or just poke them in a way, or just, you know, make them think of something. But all I want my words on the page to do is just spark that thing, and then I want them to be able to take that and live with it, you know, and create it. And so so every one of my actors, their job is to help write this character with me, help come up with their history. You know,
so an audition and a getting the job process with you is really a start of a relationship, not a hire so much.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, because we
you need to make a connection other than they read the lines well and I believe them.
I mean, in Pines there was, I think there was like three roles that I ever even auditioned, you know, out of the 56 speaking roles in that film. I auditioned, four roles. I auditioned the Dane and Emery, you know, the two kids. And then I auditioned Bradley's cop friends, Gabe Fazio and Luca Perucci. Mm-hmm. But they were, and their four auditions were all, you know, just amazing auditions. But I'm always nervous about auditions, because I feel like I don't want to peak too soon. You know, I don't want to. It's happened to me before that I've been in an audition and it's so great in the audition. Then you get on set and you keep on, you know, you've watched the audition like, you know, 100 times. You memorize the performance because you just love it. And you get on set and it's just like, oh, all of a sudden you feel like you have to do line readings, or you have to show them the tape of their audition, and nothing good is ever going to come with that. So that's why I don't like to rehearse either, because I don't want to get something that I didn't have film in the camera for.
Right.
You know, I feel like there's something to be said in like urgency or spontaneity or like first times for things, you know. And you know, sometimes it's 50, you have to take 50 times, you know. I just did a commercial that took 96 takes, you know what I mean, to finally get it right. But I never want to lose take one. I never want to lose the freshness of those moments.
So what do you do for 96 takes? Seriously. Like, were you looking for just a moment, or was it a...
I did these couple commercials that were single takes, and so they were exactly 56 seconds. So
it hit every single thing.
There was like, you know, in those 56 seconds, there was, you know, 42 beats that I wanted to hit or something, or more than that. And yeah, just wanted to perfect it. But then sometimes the ones that we got absolutely perfect had no life to them. They were robotic. And so you wanted to shake it up, you know, because I'm certainly not a technical filmmaker. I feel like I'm not really interested in technique or perfection. You know, I'm interested in imperfection, but I'm aiming for perfection. But if I get perfection, it feels dead to me. You know, I think the beauty lies in the mistakes. So in that 90, getting to the 96 takes, we ended up using take 78 of that. But it had its fair balance of perfection and mistakes, much like a human being.
So do you like doing commercials?
I do, yeah.
Different muscle group or different?
I mean, every commercial that you do, I resisted it forever, I'll say that, until I had my kids. But then I was raising my youngest son, Walker, who's 9 and a half now, and I was, buying diapers with the loose change that I had on the floor. You know, and my wife, who was breastfeeding him, was eating an avocado every day. And so I realized I should put these... nostalgic ideas of what it is to be an artist behind me, and stop being so precious and go out and get to work. And I went and did a mortgage commercial, and I have to say I was terrible. I was so rusty. The commercial was bad. I was bad. I was embarrassed. I couldn't do anything. And I realized I had been hiding from exercise. I was like an athlete who was, you know, too proud or something to go train. And to me, commercials are a great training ground, a great place, yes, to exercise certain muscles. You get to work with actors. You know, I did a genital warts campaign one time, which, you know, to me, it really helped me learn about actors, because here I was talking to these women about genital warts, and trying to get these honest performances from them about genital warts. And it was, I learned so much from it. I get to work with DPs, you know, new crews. And, you know, what do they talk about? The 10,000 hours to become a master of something. So to me, my feeling is the more time you have on set, the more opportunities you have to get better at something. And also the thing is, like with movies, look, Blue Valentine, I spent 12 years writing it. 66 drafts, 1,224 storyboards, watched it in my head every day for 12 years. And then I had 23 days to shoot it. So if you think about that ratio of like how precious that time is and how fleeting it is, that's not 23 days, you're talking 12-hour days. It's not a lot of time. It's like 12 hours to get 12 years. You know, of information into there. And so as a filmmaker, you know, you don't actually get a lot of time to practice, to be on set. I'm writing this new thing that I've been working on for a year, and hopefully I'll be in production on it next year. But by the time I get there, I want to make sure that I've kept in shape, you know?
Well, it sounds like you've made that choice for everything. It sounds like your family, your work, it sounds like having not known you when you were younger,
yeah,
it sounds like you've made this kind of maturing leap where you've kind of just embraced what is instead of what your idea of what is.
Yeah, exactly. Plus, let me say one more thing too about commercials that's great. It actually allows my work to be autonomous. It allows my work, like, I don't have to worry about making money. On my films. There was a project that I was gonna direct at one point, and I was doing it because I was broke, and it was gonna be a film, and it was gonna have my name on it, and it was gonna be my heart and soul on the screen, but I didn't really feel it. It wasn't really in my heart and soul, and I had to do it because I was broke and because I needed to make money somehow, and I couldn't do it. I quit. And after I quit, you know, I was you know, I didn't know how we were gonna, I was gonna feed my family, keep my kids in school, you know, pay the rent, you know, it's getting expensive in Brooklyn, you know, they're pushing all the artists, you have to be, the billionaires live in Manhattan and the millionaires live in Brooklyn. Yeah. So by doing commercials though, that actually, it allows me not to have to make money on movies. So I can, it actually allows me to keep my movies pure.
Powers you.
Yeah.
Sales actually does the same kind of thing, where he basically works, he teaches and does things and screenwriting jobs and whatever, basically to make enough money to make his next movie.
Yeah.
And then he pays for himself and, you know,
yeah,
deals with distribution later.
Yeah. 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 Hopefully I still get people to pay for my movies. I just don't need to get rich off of it.